Take your Bibles, please, and turn to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. Once again, good morning and welcome to this final service at the West Coast Baptist College Youth Conference. While you're turning to John chapter 1, I'd like to ask all of the youth sponsors, youth pastors, pastors, and parents who have come to this conference, would you please stand? I want to just see where you are. Come on, moms, dads, pastors, youth pastors, all over the room. I want to thank you for loving the next generation. Thank you for taking time out of your schedule to tell 7th graders and 8th graders and 9th graders and 10th graders, 11th and 12th graders that they matter to God. Let's give them another round of applause for their great, great effort and for being with us. Thank you for being here. And we're just so grateful for each and every one of the churches that are represented. Thank your pastors as well. And it's our desire to simply be a little bit of an extension of what God's already doing in your home and in your church. And I do want to thank everyone that's had a part in this great conference. What a blessing it has been. Now, John chapter 1, would you all stand with me, please, as we're going to read, beginning in verse number 6 from John chapter 1. John chapter 1 and verse number 6, we're going to read verses 6, 7, and 8, if you would follow me, please. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you this morning for the privilege of opening up the Bible. We thank you that it is without error, that it is preserved, that it is the lamp that lightens our path. So Lord, would you lighten our path this morning and teach us? And would you actually today use your word to change the entire direction in someone's life? Lord, we know there have been many great decisions made this week, but even now, speak, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. We live in a country filled with many voices crying out for many different causes. The radio is full of them, the television as well. Sometimes in schools and sometimes on social media, we hear the voices crying out for abortion, for same-sex marriage. We hear the voices crying out for legalization of drugs, and we hear voices crying out in rebellion. Sometimes we hear the voices on the radio crying out for illicit sexual relationships, and we hear voices crying out even for anarchy and rebellion. We even have a show in America called The Voice. And it is a show where finalists come together in solos and duets to sing for the opportunity to win money and perhaps make it to the finals and hit it big and get a record deal. And these singers are sometimes coached along by immoral people, ungodly people who are encouraging them to use their voice to make themselves famous and maybe to make some money. And the fact of the matter is this morning that God has given all of us a voice. God has given all of us the privilege to speak out, and yet it seems like the majority of Americans are using their voice for themselves, for some ungodly cause, maybe to make some money, but they're using their voice for everything other than what God gave them a voice for. You see, the Bible says of this man, John, in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 1, in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this was he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. I believe with all of my heart that in this needy and confused hour, every city, every high school, every Christian school, every public school needs a teenager that will use their voice to cry out the message of God to their generation. not to cry aloud or sing aloud for themselves, for the causes of unrighteousness, but to use their voice for God. The Bible says of John the Baptist in Matthew 1 and verse 11, "Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he is the least in the kingdom of heaven. He that is the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." Some 300 years after the book of Malachi in the Old Testament, God brings this man, John the Baptist, onto the scene. There are many things about him I like. I like his name. I like that name, Baptist. I was Baptist born and Baptist bred, and when I die, I'll be Baptist dead. I'm thankful for my heritage. I'm thankful for men and women who were called Anabaptists during the Reformation period and even before, because when someone got saved, they would baptize them to identify with Jesus Christ. And even if they had been sprinkled upon as infants, Anabaptists, as they were called, anti-baptizers, because we rejected infant baptism and we baptized people under the water. Many of the Anabaptists, as they were called, were drowned in rivers and were hanged because of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and because of the beliefs that we hold to today. And I'm thankful for the name Baptist. Every city needs Baptists who will stand up like John the Baptist and cry aloud for the Lord Jesus Christ. But the great thing about this man was not his name. It was not even the quality of his voice. It certainly wasn't his wardrobe. The great thing about this man was that he used his voice for God. As John the Baptist began his ministry, the religious and political climate was very, very difficult. Sometimes we think we live in the most terrible of days, and we have a lot of challenges today, but even in the days of John the Baptist, when we read history, we read about the religious scene, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, and they were ritualist, and they were materialist, and they were corrupt, and the religious scene was a terrible, terrible picture. Herod was on the throne. He was a wicked man. He was cruel and corrupt and lustful and ungodly, and he was the man in charge. And it was in this culture that God brought John the Baptist to the scene in order that he might use his voice to bring out the message of God. And as we look into the passages of the Word of God this morning, I want to spend these final moments sharing with you the testimony of a great man who used his voice to talk about a great God that his generation needed to know. A man whose voice was so effective that hundreds of thousands of people came to be baptized by him as they were repenting in their heart and as they were awaiting the coming of the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. This man, first of all, was great in his preparation. God prepared him uniquely. And I believe this is critical in every one of our lives, that we must have times of preparation. We see it going all the way back to his calling. The Bible tells us in John 1 and verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The Bible says in Luke 3 and verse 2, the word of the Lord came to him. We see that he was a man separated unto God. The religious establishment disliked him. The world disliked him. He was not particularly worried about keeping up with the culture of the day. He would not have known the popular songs of the day or dress styles of the day. He was a man that probably would have been kind of a nerd had someone observed him just passing by. Someone that might have even seemed a little bit eccentric. He was a man not really in touch with the times, but greatly in touch with God. And sometimes all of us, not just teenagers, we can worry and we can be observant of the styles of the day and the popular shows of the day and the dress styles of the day. And you can be fairly relevant and knowledgeable concerning the things of the world. But the question is, are you in touch with God? Are you walking in the Spirit? Do you pray? Do you listen to the Lord? And John was a man that was greatly in touch with God. The Bible says that he wore raiments of camel's hair and leather girdles about his loins. He had locusts and honey for a diet. He was not greatly in touch with the things of fashion, but he was greatly in touch with God. His calling came from God. And I believe today that all of you should consider the calling calling of God upon your life, and that many of you, perhaps God will touch your heart and even call you to serve the Lord in ministry. But what is so foundational to that decision is that whatever you do for God, that you know it is for God, and that you are called of God, and that you are not mama called and papa sent, and that you are not called up in the spirit of emotion, but that like John the Baptist, you will get a hold of the will of God for your life, and that you will be the voice that God has called you to be. His calling was uniquely of God. But I also see in John's preparation his training. This was a man that did not just suddenly begin preaching to the tens of thousands. God trained him, and God brought him along. God prepared him, and God is preparing you. And the preparation may have taken place at Magic Mountain. God could have taught you something there yesterday, but more than likely, he's going to train you in moments like this. He's going to teach you when the Word of God is open. We learn of John that he was born to Zacharias, a priest of the Levites, according to what was called the course of Abiah. In other words, there were many priests in that day, and we might say pastors today. Josephus tells us there were about 20,000 priests at the time of John's birth. And the Bible tells us that this man, John, was born into a religious, godly family. In fact, Luke 1 and verse 6, the Bible says, and they were both righteous, speaking of John's parents, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. Zacharias, John's father, his name meant God remembers. And Elizabeth, John's mother, her name meant the oath of God. And so he came from a strong Christian family. Now, I know that some of you come from families where mom and dad are just newly saved or maybe not saved. Some of you have a single parent family situation. All kinds of families are represented here today. But let me just pause to say that if you have a mother and a father in this day and age who love God, who bring you to church, who sing to the Lord, who try to live for the Lord, can I just stop and say, you are blessed. And you ought to be thankful for the fact that God not only has put you in a family that is caring about the things of the Lord, bringing you up in the ways of the Lord, but that you have great potential for God if you will take what you are being taught like John the Baptist did. I heard of a group of teenagers who were having a party at one of their friends' houses, and someone pulled out a beer and began to pour the beer. And a young lady said, I could never take a drink because of my father, she said. And a rebellious young man that was there at the party said, well, you afraid your dad will hurt you? To which she replied, no, I'm afraid I might hurt my father. You know, there's nothing wrong with wanting to live to please a godly father. There's nothing wrong with wanting to live in the fear of a heavenly father. The Bible teaches us in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 2, no man that warreth entangleth himself in the affairs of this life, that he may be able to please him who hath chosen him. There is a false philosophy of grace being taught in many places today that seems to say, look, you can't live the Christian life. Jesus lived it for you. Therefore, just enjoy grace. Well, the fact of the matter is that if Jesus lives in you, teenagers, you can live the Christian life by the power of the presence of the Holy Spirit of God. And the Bible teaches us that yes, we are totally accepted in the beloved, but God is not going to affirm a life that is a life of sin. In fact, the Bible says that we can actually quench the Holy Spirit and we can actually grieve the Holy Spirit. And what I believe about John the Baptist was that he was a man who lived his life in such a way that he was not quenching God, but he was pleasing God. And I believe much of that began in his family life. Life, learning from a mother and father how to fear the Lord and how to walk in the ways of God. He was raised early in his family training for God. His spiritual training was training of a consecrated life, a life that was given over to the holiness of God. As a Nazarite, he was set apart for God. He was trained in the school of the desert, if you will. A man that went out into the deserts of Judea, the Bible says. And there he learned how to pray. And there he learned how to hear the Lord. And there he meditated on the things of God. And perhaps it was his training and upbringing in the desert that created a strong spirit within him. Desert sometimes can be rugged and windblown. And sometimes people say, oh, you live there in the 661 area code. And it's kind of windy and rugged up in Lancaster. Yes, it is. But I want to tell you something, that sometimes God will use the ruggedness of life and the difficulties of life and the dry times of life to teach us how to pray and how to depend upon God. And John the Baptist had an early life with a godly family, and sometimes in the rugged wilderness where he was alone with God, but all of this was God's plan. And sometimes you may feel that you're alone and in your school the only one that stands for God, or you're going through a hard time today and no one seems to understand it. But I want you to understand this, that God makes no mistakes, and that all things work together for good to those who love God and are the called according to his purpose. And God will use the difficulties of life to prepare you for greater service in the days to come. In fact, the Bible says of John in Luke chapter 1 and verse 80, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit and was in the deserts until the day of his showing unto Israel. God many times puts his people through desert experiences before he puts them on the platform to use their voice for him. I like the fact that West Coast Baptist College is in a desert. And sometimes I like to tell people in Ohio and North Carolina and Florida when I'm preaching, hey, God does some good work in desert places, whether it was Moses on the backside of the desert or John the Baptist in the wilderness of Judea. Sometimes it's a good thing to spend a few years in the desert place getting ready for the work of God. That was true in the life of John the Baptist. He was great in his preparation. Students, please let me encourage you, when your youth pastor's speaking and when your parents are admonishing and when your pastor's pouring his heart out trying to help you, don't fold your arms and close your eyes, but thank God for the preparation you're getting at this early time in your life, because John the Baptist, who had such a great voice for Jesus, was someone that was great first in his preparation for the Lord. But notice, if you would, secondly, he was a man great in his purpose. Now, I want you to think about his purpose. Really, it was fairly simple. John the Baptist had this purpose: to prepare the way of the Lord. Let's say that together. To prepare the way of the Lord. One more time. To prepare the way of the Lord. He was the forerunner of Jesus Christ. He was getting his generation ready for the day when he would see Jesus coming down the pathway along the Jordan River, and he was preparing his generation to meet Jesus. And I am preparing my generation to meet Jesus. And every God called soul winner and Christian must be preparing their generation to see Jesus, because Jesus Christ is coming again. Now, Malachi had prophesied that this man would preach. Malachi 3 and 1. Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. Now, John the Baptist's ministry was what I would call a preparatory ministry. He was preparing people to meet the Lord Jesus Christ. And our ministry is a preparatory ministry. When I go out soul winning, when I preach on Sunday mornings, and when I testify of the Lord Jesus Christ, I am preparing people to meet God. That's what my life's purpose is as a pastor. I am spending my life preparing people to meet God. There's many other things I could do. I suppose I could found some type of a corporation. I suppose I could be a farmer. I'd love to be a farmer. My family are all farmers. I suppose I could be a surf bum. I mean, there's many things I could do with my life. But God called me at an early age, as a seventh grader, 13 years old. God said, I have a purpose for your life. You're going to prepare people for the day that they meet their God. That's what you're going to spend your life doing. You're going to preach the word of God, and you're going to preach the gospel, because life is but a vapor. And one day, people are going to stand before God. The Harvard Business Review recently published a study, and they found that 9 out of 10 employees would be willing to trade a cut in their paycheck in order to feel like they were doing something meaningful. The average employee would trade 23% of their total earnings in order to have a job that made them feel like they have a real purpose. I want to tell you something about being in the ministry, being a pastor, a missionary, a Christian school teacher, whatever. I want you to know that we have the greatest purpose in life, that we get to use our voice, not to be evangelists for Tesla, not to be evangelists for Microsoft, not to be a salesman for Sears, not to be a salesman for some store like Nike. We're not using our voice, we're not using our talents to promote the wares of this world, but I get to get up every morning and use every talent that God has given to me and use the voice that God has given me to proclaim the goodness and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And teenagers, that's a great thing to live for. A great purpose indeed, to live, to tell others about Jesus Christ. Now, John the Baptist was humble with this purpose. Sometimes people tried to trick him up. On one occasion, the priest said to him, "Who art thou?" They wanted to kind of label him and put him in their ecclesiastical museum and say, "Oh, he's one of those. Who art thou?" they said. And John said in chapter 1 and verse 22, "Then saith to him, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah." Here we see a mingling of strength and humility. In some ways, he was much more than a voice, but in reality, he really was just a voice. He was the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And this is a humility that always accompanies someone who has a proper view of Jesus Christ. This would be the person like John the Baptist who said, "He must increase, but I must decrease." And most of us spend our lives trying to increase ourselves. We try to increase the way we look and who we know. And sometimes people, teenagers, will say jokes against one person to tear them down, to build themselves up. They'll cut this one down and cut that one down. And sometimes are cruel to the point of even pushing other teenagers to suicide. And sometimes we live in a world where people are constantly trying to build themselves up. But when you get a hold of your purpose in life, if it's a purpose for Jesus, you'll say this: "It's not about me anymore, it's about Jesus Christ. He must increase." And you know, the fact is, the longer you live, the more you'll learn that all that really matters is knowing Jesus and making Jesus known. That's really all that matters in life. Years ago, I took Brother Sisk, who's the chairman of our missions department, to a golfing tournament out in Palm Springs. He loves golf, and we stood at the 18th hole, and Brother Sisk, when he gets out in a situation like that, when you go to a golf course, you're supposed to be very quiet. You're not supposed to say a word. They even hold up signs that say quiet, and they look mean at you if you're a little noisy. But that didn't stop Brother Sisk. In fact, I remember he saw Phil Mickelson, and we're standing about 5-6 yards from Phil Mickelson, and Phil Mickelson's just getting ready on his backswing, and Brother Sisk said, "Hit a good one, Phil!" Just like that, scared Phil to death. Everyone was making him be quiet, and I was acting like I didn't know who he was. And we were standing there watching these golfers, and at the end of the day, there was a group coming towards us. And as they were coming towards us, one in the group was Jerry Rice, a famous football player, and then a professional, and then was President Ford at that time, who was still alive, and another professional golfer. And there was a little boy standing there next to me. He had a football, and I say little boy, he might have been maybe 5th, 6th grade, and he was going to get Jerry Rice to sign his football, and I had a program, so I thought, you know, I'm going to get the president to sign this program. I'm going to get President Ford to sign this program. So President Ford came by, and I held out the program. I held out my pen. Here's my famous conversation with President Ford. "My pen broke," and he said, "Your pen broke." I said, "Yes, sir, I'm sorry." I grabbed the pen from the boy next to me, gave it to the president, and he signed my program. And he was standing there talking to someone, and Jerry Rice came by, and the little boy put the football out, and Jerry Rice kind of waved him off and kept walking by, and the boy was kind of dejected. And then the president came by the little boy, and the little boy held out his football, and the president signed his football. And I'll never forget what the little boy said to me after that. He looked up at me, and he said, "Who is that guy anyways?" the president of the most powerful country in all the world, and just a few years removed from his presidency, and someone says, who is that guy anyways? Teenagers, all that's going to matter in this life is what we do for Jesus Christ. Our time here is fleeting. Our significance is really nothing compared to the great need to get Jesus Christ and his message out to a lost and dying world. And John the Baptist learned that in the desert. He learned he must increase, I must decrease. He was thankful that he could be a part of telling others about Jesus. In fact, in John chapter 3, the Jews came and they said to John, there's starting to be more people following Jesus than are following you. There's a greater following after Jesus. And John said in verse 27, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. In other words, he was happy that people were following Jesus Christ. He was thankful for his purpose. He was bold in his purpose. One of the things I love about John the Baptist is that he was no respecter of persons. I mean, he just stood up and preached the truth and preached the gospel in Mark chapter 6 and verse 18 when Herod was living in sin. This is what John the Baptist said. John said unto Herod, it is not lawful for thee to have thy brother's wife. He was a man living in wickedness. And we see today a church in a society where the society has so many questions, and yet the church is stuttering. They can't get the answers out, and yet John the Baptist didn't stutter. Why? He was a voice, that's why. And he used his voice for God. And when he saw sin, even in high places, he said, look, it's not right for you to live that way. And I don't think we need unfriendly or even ungodly spirits, but we do need truthful messengers today. Men and women who will stand up and say, hey, it's not right to take the life of a child in its mother's womb. That life began at conception. And now we're hearing people talk about infanticide, where, whoops, the child slipped out of the mother's womb and was born. So let's just kill the child while it's just a few minutes old. Hey, somebody's got to be a voice enough to say, that is sin. That is wrong. Sadly, as demographic studies roll out, we're being told that younger Baptists have fewer convictions. 55% of millennial Baptists said in a poll last week that they're good with homosexuality. An ungodly contemporary Christian singer, Laura Daigle, was interviewed on The Ellen Show. They asked her, what do you think about homosexuality? She said, well, I'm not God, you know. I just really can't say. Well, look, I'm not God either, teenagers, but I know him. And I know what he says on that matter. And somebody's got to use their voice to say that God in Romans 1 says that that lifestyle is not natural. It is an abomination to God. And we see in John the Baptist that though he was humble, he was bold enough to stand up and to say what God said on the matter. And we've got to have bold preaching if we're going to have revival in this land once again. I often read a quote that has meant something to me from John Adams in 1754. Our second president said, and listen to this, it is the duty of the clergy to accommodate their discourses to the times, to preach against such sins as are most prevalent, and to recommend such virtues as are most needed. When this great republic was founded, this great country got going. Our leaders, many of them were Christians, they said, hey, we need pastors to use their voice to preach against sin and to preach for things that are good. And when the church fails to be that voice, and when Christian teenagers are cursing and listening to the same music and saying the same junk that the unsaved say, then you are wasting your voice. God did not give you a voice to say, oh, look at this rock star. Look at this country star. God did not give you your voice so that you could curse or gossip. God gave you a voice so that you could speak up for Jesus Christ. What are you doing with your voice? Christian teenagers, oh, did you see that guy on The Voice? Oh, he was so cute. Oh. Let me tell you what that boy is without Jesus. He is a wasted life. he's a wasted life. What we ought to be saying is, hey, did you see that eighth grade girl pass out that gospel tract for Jesus Christ? Hey, did you see that 10th grade boy over there talking to the guy at the gas station about Jesus? That is awesome. That is way, way, way more awesome than singing on The Voice. What's the most awesome thing you can do with your voice? It's not singing some sensual song. It's talking about Jesus. That's why God gave you a voice. What are you doing with your voice? John the Baptist made much of Jesus with his voice. He was great in his preparation in the desert. He was great in his purpose to declare God to his generation. And then I want you to notice finally that he was a man who was great in his power. The power of God on this man's life amazes me. Hundreds of thousands of people came from all over Judea to hear him preach. And when I study John's life, I learn a few very interesting things about the power of God in him. First, I learned that there is power in a pure witness. There's power in a pure witness. John 1:7, he came to be a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. Jesus describes John the Baptist in John 5:35. He says, he was a burning and a shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. He was a man of the light. He walked in the light. He had a life that was pure, and it was not a light of darkness, but it was a life of proximity to the light. And I want to say, teenager, that yes, if you sin, and you will, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin. But how many teenagers today, when they sin and when they entertain ungodly thoughts, they feel unworthy to witness, they feel guilty, they sometimes wonder, are they even saved? And what I want you to realize is that as you walk in the light, then you begin to have a God-like confidence, and you begin to trust and obey, and you begin to realize that God can use you, and Satan loves to trip us up. But here was a man who had power in a very pure witness, and he was a man that was illuminating and illuminated by the Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew 3:11, the Bible says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Now that the Holy Spirit has come, we don't have to wait for a baptism of the Holy Spirit. We get to receive the Holy Spirit at the moment that we are saved. We are born again by the Holy Spirit. Every one of you can have the fire. Every one of you can have the purity. Every one of you. No, I'm not talking about a moralistic list. I'm not talking about just keeping rules. Rules are fine, but the way that you're going to have the fire in your life is the Holy Spirit's presence in your life. He'll help you keep the rules. Hey, you can't keep the rules on your own, but with God, you can obey the word, and by the Spirit, you can walk according to the precepts of the Word of God. And John the Baptist was a powerful man because he walked in the light of Jesus Christ and in the power of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. You say, Brother Chapel, it's impossible for me to be like this. One girl in my youth group, her parents, I mean, she's probably never seen alcohol, never heard cussing. She comes from a perfect family. I want to tell you something. Walking in the light and walking in the Spirit is not something given to just those kids that are from a, quote, perfect home. And by the way, there's no such thing as a perfect home. Everyone here can walk in the Spirit. We had a funeral here a few days ago in this auditorium for a young man that I held when he was born in dedication prayer. He graduated from our high school. He came to our college. He met his beautiful wife here. John Tanner was his name. He married Jess. She was from Nashville area in Tennessee. And as we were with John for many months in prayer, through a battle with cancer, he was 29 years old. And I think the thing that just amazed me the most at his funeral was to see John through the witness of his co-workers, to hear his captain speak of him. I think I might have a picture of John this morning here behind me. Highway patrol officer, has two little boys, and one will be born very soon. I'll never forget John's captain from the station not far from here standing in the pulpit and weeping, a huge man, weeping for 20 minutes as he talked about John. He said, you know, John was just a little guy. He was about 5'8", maybe 5'9". And he said, his training officer, when the wind would blow in Lancaster, his training officer would say, John, you better put some rocks in your pocket so you don't blow away. But he said, one of the most amazing things about John was when he told his training officer, he said, you know, I don't really know how to tell if someone's driving drunk because I've never tasted alcohol. I've never smelled alcohol before. I didn't know that he needed to be arrested because I didn't know that's what that smell was. And this captain, as he was weeping, said this was a man who actually listened to his parents, who actually believed what his church taught. This was a man who actually abstained from things that would be harmful to him. He said this was a man that had invited all of us to church. He was a man that would not laugh at the jokes that were told. And because of his witness, several have been saved, and I believe several more will be saved. Why? Because of a small man in stature who had a powerful witness, and he was a burning light for Jesus Christ, and he wasn't huge, and maybe he didn't have the talents that some other had, but he had a life, he had a purity of life, and when people saw his life, then they listened to his voice, and he used his voice for Jesus Christ. There's power in a pure witness. Hey, it's hard to be talking trash one minute and then invite people to church the next minute. John the Baptist had a pure witness. But there's also power in the preached word. Power in the preached word. Luke 3:3. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Matthew 3:1. And in those days, John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Paul said to Timothy, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, he said, the instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Here, John the Baptist was a man who preached repentance. He said to his generation, hey, wait a minute, you've got to change your mind about sin. You've got to change your mind about your direction. You've got to change your mind about God. And we need some 15-year-olds and some 16-year-olds who will preach repentance to your generation and call your generation back so that they'll stop worshiping the gay agenda and the ungodly and defiled rock and roll stars and stop putting their pictures on their Facebook and retweeting their wicked thoughts. And somebody's got to say, enough, let's turn away from this culture and turn back to our God. Amen. John the Baptist preached repentance. Many churches today do not preach a message of repentance. It seems that as long as we go to church, we can kind of live however we want. But John the Baptist said, no, when you meet Jesus, your life's going to change. He preached repentance, and of course, he preached salvation. And this is the best way to use your voice, to tell someone else how they can know that they're on their way to heaven. The Bible says in John chapter 1 and verse 29, as John was baptizing one day, he looked out on the horizon and he saw the similitude of a figure that he recognized, and he said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. Would you say that with me? Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. A little louder. Behold, the Lamb of God. What a name. What a strange name. Why would you call a man a lamb? Why would he look at Jesus and say, behold, the Lamb of God? Could it be that every lamb that was ever sacrificed in the Old Testament on the Day of Atonement was a picture of the Lamb to come? Could it be that when Abraham went up Mount Moriah and when he held the knife over his son and God provided a ram, and that could it be that all of these were picturing the coming Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ? And the Bible says in Hebrews 9:22, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of the blood, there there is no remission of sin. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, came in order that he might shed his blood so that all of us who are sinners, who believe on Jesus Christ, can be washed in the blood and we can have our sins atoned for and a home in heaven. You talk about a purpose for which to use your voice to tell your generation there's a God in heaven who loved them so much that he gave his only begotten son and that he shed his blood and that he allowed the Roman soldiers to put the nails through his hands and his feet and the crown of thorns upon his head, and that that blood washed away the sins of the world so that all that would come to him, whosoever will, may be saved. That means your seventh grade friends and your 12th grade friends who don't know Jesus, they're just waiting to hear your voice on the matter. They don't need to hear your voice about some rock star. They hear that all the time. They need to hear your voice about Jesus Christ. They need to hear your voice crying out in this wilderness. John the Baptist preached repentance, and he preached salvation. And he bare witness of Jesus Christ, the preeminent, preexistent Son of God, in whom dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And I can imagine in my heart, as John the Baptist was there preaching, and suddenly, after all these years of waiting and 30 years of preaching, Jesus appears on the Jordan near Jericho. I can imagine the joy in his heart. And I'll tell you what I believe. I believe that someday I may be preaching somewhere. Someday I'll be serving the Lord. And I believe with all of my heart the trump of God will sound, and the dead in Christ will rise, and we which are alive and remain will join them. And I know sometimes when you're in the seventh grade, all you want to do is get old enough to get a car, or all you want to do is get old enough to go to college or have a girlfriend or have that experience. And I hope you get all those experiences, but there is one experience that eclipses all the others, and that is the day when Jesus Christ will step forth and will call us to be with him. And then my purpose will be fulfilled, for my faith will have become sight. And I pray that I'll hear those words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Jesus is coming again. Don't waste your voice on the world's music and the world's jokes and the world's sarcasm. Use your voice to be the messenger of God. We need Baptists today who will get a hold of the preparation of the desert, that you'll let God prepare your heart, prepare your life for ministry. We need Baptists today who will purpose to say, "Behold the Lamb of God," who will seek the power of God for your life. 33 years ago, I came to this desert. I came to speak about one person, the Lord Jesus Christ. I began preaching to 12 people and didn't know a whole lot about preaching. I just opened up passages and studied and tried to put the messages together, but every message was about Jesus. I began knocking on doors, 500 doors a week, just trying to use my voice to tell people about Jesus. I've been to many mission fields just trying to tell people about Jesus, and I've tried to be faithful to my calling. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it, just spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. And I'm thankful to testify to you and to the glory of God that as we just keep talking about Jesus and saying, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord," that in these 33 years we've seen over 30,000 people accept Jesus Christ as their Savior through the ministry of this church, and some 15,000 of them follow the Lord in believers' baptism. And there's nothing special about me, and there's nothing special about this church. We just have got a hold of our purpose, and our purpose is to make known the way of the Lord and to use our voice to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you've got a choice on how to use your voice. It's up to you, my friend. God gave you a voice to use for the Lord Jesus Christ, to use your voice for Jesus. Some will use their voice for drugs. Some will use their voice for abortion. Some will use their voice to talk about their angry cause. But we need a generation of teenagers to say, as John the Baptist, "I just believe God didn't put me in a Christian home by accident. God didn't bring me out here to the desert to go to Magic Mountain. God didn't put me in a Christian school so that I could just live for myself. I believe God's preparing me for something. And God didn't give me a voice to swear and to talk about myself. I believe God gave me a voice to talk about Jesus. I mean, we got to think about this. Why are we here? And why did God give us the voice? And are there some in this room? And you would say, I'll use my voice like Brother Chapel did to preach Jesus the rest of my life. I want to use my voice so that others can know and hear the good news of Jesus Christ, because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So how are you using your voice? What does God want you to do with your voice? Are you going to be someone screaming on the 10 o'clock news for the rights of turtles? Are you going to be someone screaming your concern for the whales? And we should be concerned for turtles and whales, but where are the people concerned for lost souls? Who will lift their voice for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? The voice, it's much more than a worldly competition. It's you fulfilling the calling of God for your life. In these final moments today, I want you to consider how you're using your voice. I want you to consider that God may be calling you like some of those in the Bible, including John the Baptist. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Would you say that with me? There was a man sent from God whose name was, right? Now I want to say that, and when we get to John, I want you to say your name, all right? There was a man sent from God whose name was, just as surely as God used John's voice, He wants to use your voice for your generation. Will you let Him use your voice?